has James Neal Harris, running for the 8th Congressional District. Next, we're going to get candidate Gregory Williams. He's running for State Senator in the 8th District. So put your hands together, Gregory. Again, that's Gregory Williams running for State Senator 8th District. I like your hat. Mine's a little better. Just a little bit better than yours. All right, do we have Dexter Sharper? Was he able to make it? I don't think Dexter was able to make it. We're actually going to ask, since Brad Carter and John Hogan are in a contested race, we're actually going to ask them to come up next. Brad Carter, you want to come up? He's coming over here. The guys are on their break, so they'll be back. We don't have any Brad Carter music.
First of all, thank you for the opportunity to be here tonight and speak with you. It's both an honor and a pleasure. As you just heard, I'm Brad Carter and I'm running for the office, for the coroner's office in Lowndes County. I've been the deputy coroner here in Lowndes County since 2012. I'm a resident of Lake Park and a lifelong resident of Lowndes County. Graduated from Lowndes High in 1980. Went on to the University of Georgia and got a Bachelor of Science in 1986. Upon graduation, I returned to Lowndes County, raised my two children, my daughter Evan, my son Buck, on the same land that I was raised on. As with me and you, our community means a lot to me. I've been involved with youth coaching for over 20 years, president of dugout clubs, member of the Lake Park United Methodist Church. I sit on the board. Sit on the board of Homes for Heroes, and I want to just give up real quick tonight, tell you a little bit about the corner, what we do. The corner system is used in the majority of the counties in Georgia. It's governed by Title 45, which is called the Death Investigation Act. The corner's main duty is to find manner and cause of death. Once death has been pronounced, the coroner has additional responsibilities and underlying duties for the deceased as well as the family members. The cause of death is exactly what it sounds like. It's the cause of death. The manner of death, there's five legal terms for that. It's natural, suicide, homicide, accidental, and undetermined. Unfortunately, death is a daily occurrence here in our community. In Lowndes County last year, for example, there were 346 coroner cases. We average about 340 a year. This does not include the number of calls we receive night and day from the South Georgia Medical Center of cases that we determined not to be for the coroner. Basically, it's critical that the coroner you elect has the experience, competency, and compassion this job. So why Brad Carter coroner? Let me tell you. I'm the only person in this race with the experience on the job for the job. I've been the deputy coroner, like I said, since 2012. I've worked over 450 cases. I've assisted surrounding counties with death investigations. I'm a member of the Georgia Coroners Association. Also a member of the Lowndes County Child Fatality Review Board. Competency. I'm the only candidate that's competent to hold this office of coroner because of my knowledge and because of my experience. Besides the coroner, the office employs a part-time deputy coroner. This office does not employ any administrative assistants, so we do our own faxing, our own file, answer our own phone, open our own mail, return emails. The funding for the coroner's office is solely provided by the Lowndes County Board of Commissioners with no other income sources. That means it's important to run an efficient operation while minimizing and cutting unnecessary expenses, all while making sure that the office has what it needs to serve the citizens adequately and professionally without being a burden on the taxpayer. Over the last 4 years, I have proved that I am competent and I am capable of being your coroner. Finally, and just as important as experience and competency, there there's compassion. I have compassion for this job. Before I began as deputy coroner, did not realize how vital this position was to our county, citizens and families who I've come in contact with over the years. Every death is traumatic, whether it's natural or otherwise. Family and friends and loved ones of the deceased, they all look to the coroner for answers, for guidance. Have a strong faith, along with the experience of hundreds of cases. I know how to give compassion and comfort, all while doing my job as an investigator. Again, this job calls for experience, competency, and compassion. And I'm the only person in the race that has already demonstrated those qualities for me. Look, promises have been made by other candidates. We had five to start out with, which is really amazing. I don't know any other county that's ever had five run the corner. Promises were made. Candidates have never stepped foot into the coroner's office, much less investigated a death of any kind. On the other hand, I've lived it every day for 4 years. I've worked side by side with law enforcement, medical, funeral home personnel, and I've embraced many, many grief and loved ones. I mean, so your choices are getting slimmer, but they're basically your choices, promises that may or may not be realistic for the coroner's office. Person who's already in place, myself, that knows exactly what it takes to be the Lyons County coroner. So I ask for your support, your vote, your prayers. I'd be honored to be and humbled to serve you, the people of Lyons County, as your next coroner. Thanks again for this time. And I'm glad to get that in another 5 minutes to my heart. Thank you.
That was Brad Carter. Next we're going to hear from John Hogan for the same position. $175 per case.
All right, 340 deaths, 390 deaths a year, trying to figure out how much that would come up to. Well, let's try this approach. And what you do and what you love to do is in your heart. Take salary. Don't take 70,000 a year. Don't take 80,000 a year. Take 35,000 a year. Take $30,000 a year, 40,000 a year. And give the rest to your deputy partner, who should be on salary, part-time salary. And if the county commission allows it, so you should have two more deputies that's per case. If the coroner and the deputy coroner cannot be present during this time. That's how you save money. That's one thing. Another thing is a coroner's unit. We need a coroner unit. Because at the scene of a crime, you want your team there to assess the scenes. You want your team there to ask the necessary questions. And you want your team to ask and respond back to you. What is that we need to do and what is the next step? See if you're a death investigator, ask those types of questions. Because you want to find out what's your next step as coroner. Also, fatalities on I-75. When you call the coroner shouldn't even call this coroner's duty to pick bodies up on the interstate. Because there's money allocated for that. And instead of outsourcing the funds, we must keep those funds in-house to fuel that department, and then you won't have to borrow money from other areas or pull money out of certain budgets. Which you're supposed to operate the thing as a business. It takes money to run a department, it takes money to run a business. So we have to look at what's coming in. And we have to pay close attention to what's coming out. And we have to look at those things. We have to look at these numbers. You ever heard of a person starting a business and then broke before they even got started? It's because you got to plan. You got to know where your weakness is. And whatever it is that you can't do, you should get someone that can do it better than you think. So if there's certain areas you feel, hey, I'm not strong yet this area. Well, who do I have as my deputy that's strong in that area? Also, there are some other things I want to touch on is compassion. Compassion is a must in a job like this. I worked in Human Dialysis. I ran the Human Dialysis Department in Smith for about 6 years before they shut the department down. And also in Human Dialysis, most people tell you either you're going to hate it or you're going to love it. You have to have compassion. You have to be there to help that patient that's there for 3 to 4 hours that's connected to that machine every other day. You have to understand their needs. And you have to understand their family needs. Because not only is that patient affected, but the family is affected. So you're watching transition through years. See, that's just one part of compassion. I'd like to say that we have to start somewhere, okay? If we're metro, I don't have to tell you and I don't have to convince you of certain things that we need in our county. Either you see it or you don't see it. One thing you do not see is mobility. Why not? Firefighters have ability. The police departments have ability, city and county. So wouldn't it be efficient for the coroner's departments to have it? So when you say you have experience in certain areas, when you say you're doing things and you're doing certain jobs, well, we're going to ask you, why don't we see that? Because we don't see that. And I'm a businessman myself. I started my first business at the age of 15, still an outlander. And I go to school, I buy a pack of outlanders, and I sell them like 5 cents a piece. Okay? And just right at the start, I've been an entrepreneur. During my tenure at Smith Northview Hospital, I actually wrote my first patent application, and now it's called hemodialysis medical device. And I did the application myself. I paid it in like 2012-13 and right now that's being considered. about pharmaceutical tech and technological companies. Also, I brought the department from making like $5,000 a month to making $168,000 a month, $172,000 a month. But you look at areas of your weakness and you find out what do I need to do to optimize? What do I need to do to change to make it better? If it's not working, I'm going to continue doing it the same way. You see, I'm a business owner myself. I started my transportation company at age 24. I told myself, hey, I say self say what? I say, John Hogan, you paying almost $2,000 for tires every day, I mean every month, night and day. Now I was telling people, man, a tire doesn't know whether it's night or day. If it goes out, it goes out. I said, oh my God, I want to spread a need. I said, okay, so the only logical thing to do would be to start a tire shop. So I started Valdosta County's first 24-hour tire shop. And I actually saved money for fixing a problem. You see, so I said, well, why not just do it, not just do it for myself, but do it for Lyons County as well. See, and do it not only in the daytime, but do it at night too. Because you see there's a need for something, and you see what you can do as a city, as a people, and as a county to fill that void. And that's what I'm here for, the performance department. I'm not making any promises that I know I can't feel. I just know one thing. If something's not done right, if someone's not willing to step up to the plate, then you're going to see me there. I ran for city council in 2013. When I seen it was a problem, I was there. You see, so right now, in Lyons County, what we need is someone in the performance department that can mobilize, that can optimize. And we need to do that now. I mean, with Metro, let's think and let's act as Metro and let's act in a unified manner. That's what I'm here for. I'm not here to play any games. I'm not here to sell you anything that I say I can't do. But one thing is my track record speaks for itself and these things that you can see. So I don't have to convince anyone. But one thing we can see is we need to have certain things allocated for Lyons County. If we have a disaster here, you got two corners, you got a corner, you got a deputy. There's one going south, one going north. Who's going to go east, who's going to go west? Are you going to borrow a corner from another county? But the people of Lyons County elect you to be the corner, not the person in the nearby county. See, with a corner, a deputy corner, two other deputy corners there, that's by per case. If it gets to that point, you can save the county money. If a county corner, deputy corner, oh yeah, right, no, sorry. If a corner, deputy corner can handle the case themselves, that's good. But God forbid, there's a disaster, we need to be able to mobilize, optimize. I'm calling my other two corners saying, I wouldn't know if you go south, you go east, you go west. Now we're going to have to go on a certain cause, and we're going to do what's necessary. So that's why I say, hey, let's get someone in the office that knows what they're talking about, that knows what they're doing, and someone that knows numbers. The department is just like a business. We must act, we must talk, we must think as a business. And thank you, and by all means, tomorrow, vote John Hogan for corner, and I appreciate your time. Thank you, guys.
That was again, John Hogan. Running for court? Oh, no, sir. All right, next we're going to get Ashley Paul to come on up and talk to us. We need a little Ashley Paul music, please. On your own.
Sheriff for 16 years. down and talking about, you know, the training and everything else. We have a national recognized here. I have good people, wonderful people, people with you, you surround yourself with good people. So, we're nationally recognized. We were well trained. We did not encounter a lot of difficulties in the Walmart County. A lot of that has to do with your men and your leadership. I'm a very compassionate person. I know more than this one for 16 years. Never felt like I needed to use common sense, compassion, you can run that department. So that's the way I'd like to run it again. I was also county commission chairman, I sent some commissions here. I like challenges, so I decided I'd be a commission chairman during the worst economic time in Miles County ever had. I think I'm the only chairman that ever built anything, but I did tear down my pretty good. But I do know money, I do know budgets. Sheriff's office is the largest single budget commission I have to deal with. So we're $18 million. I intend to cut $500,000 out of the first 60 days up there. I can do it, I know where it's at. But also, you don't just spend money there. In my 16 years, these public figures, I brought in $97 million. It came back to the taxpayer. Taxes are important. You don't, you know, we don't have another tax increase. It's unborn. Dollars are going up, salaries are going up. We've got to look at our people. I'm not going to sound conditional by any means. I mean, you've got a certain amount of dollars. I've been there. I mean, so I've seen both sides of the things. I intend to help them with that. Tend to relieve some of the pressure on them. How long since you've seen a car that bought the city's funds? You're in that mind one day. They don't exist. But, you know, I'm going to go back. We're going to get our funds up and people's cost problems. I don't anticipate. I tend to be the type leader, type chair. You're going to need law enforcement like this now. You're going to need somebody strong. You're going to need somebody with compassion and understanding. This is some of the worst times of law enforcement. And it's not all law enforcement's fault. It's not all the public's fault. It's just a nationwide problem. But I intend to be as good a sheriff as I ever was, probably a better sheriff. But I've watched a lot of things, learned a lot of things, and I'm always learning. And you know, people ask me, so who are you going to bring back down there? I have great people. I'm not bringing anybody back, because if I did, I would kill them right. I had a young man out there waiting for promotion. He didn't get it. What have I done to him? I'm going to tell you, I'm going to do the way I put it. I'm going to take some rocks over there and make some diamonds. But I need your support. I need your thoughts. I need your prayers. We can redo it. We can have a great sheriff's department. And then we'll be a Democrat, too. And don't worry about me if you could let me change the course. Like I said, this is my 10th time as a Democrat. And if I run 100 times, 110. But this 10th, we've got to get it behind us first. And I appreciate your thoughts, your prayers, and your anything else that you can help me with, any advice. I love advice. But I hope we can do this again. Thank you.
Okay, next we have Jason,
Crane.
I'm sorry, we're going to have Mike Hill is going to speak with us. He's going to, Felicia Williams is going to come up next. Tax Commissioner, Felicia, you want to come on up?
One thing I want to say is that I love this county. This is one of the greatest counties in the state of Georgia, and we serve some of the greatest citizens. I've worked in the Miles County Tax Commissioner's Office for 25 plus years. I have over 620 hours of training from the state of Georgia. Currently, I'm occupying the Office of Tax Commissioner, where I am so happy to serve each and every one of you. What you don't know about the tax commissioner's office is that we do not raise your tax. We only collect. And we distribute to each entity, and we collect about $74 million. So it is a huge undertaking. One of the greatest responsibilities for the tax commissioner's office is that Lowndes County stay in compliance with the state of Georgia. There's not one thing we do in our office we cannot issue a tag or issue a mobile home decal unless we are in compliance with the state of Georgia. This is an office that takes someone with great integrity. It's an office that takes someone that has a lot of compassion. I am a working tax commissioner. I have held almost every position in that office. I can go from tax commissioner submitting a budget to a tag and tax clerk at the turn of a dime. You can stop by at any time and I'll be in my office and I will be so happy to help you. We are very taxpayer friendly. We'll be able to assist you in whatever tax amount that you need. We're also responsible for making sure that your taxpayer rights are protected. So if you have a chance, stop by and see me. But most of all, don't forget who I am. I'm Felicia Williams, your tax commissioner now, and I hope to be your tax commissioner in January. Thank you, and vote Felicia Williams, tax commissioner at Lowndes County.
Okay, next we do have Mike Hill is going to be coming up to speak with us.
I can't shrunk.
We have our 3 month member board, Lowndes County Board of Assessors. I'm WQ Walker. I'm chairman of my field, Bob Chairman, General Butler, in the jurisdiction. And that all three of us talk, they just said, we have that Mike talk, all three of us.
Hello. Hello, Court, you do. Leroy and WG and I didn't have any opposition. I'm not running this time. And Leroy was appointed by the governor. I'm third tax assessor, mental ill. And I said tax assessor, we're assessors, like Felicia, we don't set the taxes. We don't even collect them. We set a value for the property. And the condition then sets value puts applies the millage rate to that value of your taxes. There is one thing on the ballot, though, that is going to affect us. It'll be on the ballot in November. It won't come into play until 4 years from now. There's a referendum to decide whether assessors should be elected or appointed. The county commission appears to think that we should be appointed. That has gone both ways in Lowndes County. Toward the end of the last century, the assessor's office was in such bad shape, mostly because of unqualified staff and leadership, the state of Georgia rolled in and said that every piece of property was to be appraised in the county. It cost the county $1 million to get it done, using outside contractors to meet the deadline. Who was the best? It's now highly qualified, and people in it are either certified or working on becoming certified to do what their job is. Much of that is due to the late Earl Weatherington, who served for 16 years and he got that in the job is where it should be. And we are committed to keeping it that way. There are 48,000 tax parcels in the county and growing with every subdivision. There's not enough staff to cover all the annual transactions. And that's as it should be. We have enough staff to cover 48,000 parcels every year. It would be far too many and far too much money. Putting it very simply, massively oversimplifying it, people say my taxes went up 10% because they get that bill from us that says that their value of their property went up 10%. It did, 1 year, if you take the clock face and divide it up between 12 and 3, 3 and 6, 69, 9 and 12, the assessors will do that section of the county between 12 and 3. The next section will be 3 and 6. As I said, they can't get it off. And this is oversimplified. Between 6 and 9, 9 and 12, and sometimes a little longer. So if we were in that first section of the county, that first quadrant, when that came through, it may be 4 or 5 years before they got around the year. During that period of time, you probably could have gone up or gone down. If they did go up, then you got a free ride for 2 or 3 or 4 years. But when they finally got back around to your property, if it went up, it's going to show up all at one time. And it'll be a shock, probably. But that's the reason. What the county would apparently like to do is have assessors reporting by the county. Now, if you want, if we take away the citizen's right to vote, the property owner's right to vote, it would affect the way that the Department of Revenue treats us. Now, the Department of Revenue, when it comes to appointing versus elected assessors, there's no difference. It refers to it in just one small paragraph, and it has nothing to do with the way the office is operating. We have to follow all the state regulations and the laws. Everything has been on the ballot twice before, both times in the last century, both times losing by a wide margin. If that referendum is passed, the next batch of assessors will be appointed 4 years from now, not next year, as some people have said. By that time, I'll be 73 years old, so I doubt it's going to make any difference to me. But there are several reasons why appointing assessors may not be a good idea for the rest of the taxpayer. Right now, if you don't like an assessor, you can vote him out. It's just your vote and one assessor. If the assessor is appointed by the county commission, how do you get an assessor? You're going to have to vote the county commissioner out. And it is reasonable to think that at least some of the assessors are going to have some of the county commissioners are going to have their head assessors. They can pressure the assessors in keeping the property values up, and they may not have to raise the millage rate. They look like heroes. The tax digest goes up, the millage rate goes down. I can't imagine any other reason that they want to afford them other than consolidating more power. And as long as you've got a vote, keep a vote. Don't give up that vote to the county commission. The county commission's got some good people in it right now, but that's not guaranteed. Based on my experience for the last 4 years, I've no doubt that appointed assessors would be much more vulnerable to being pushed in one direction than another, based on which way local elected officials want to see them governed. I don't know why an appointed elected assessor would want that job anyway. Whoever appoints you, loyalty could very well be to them. In fact, you're loyalty between the voters, the Department of Revenue, and the judicial enforcement, that would be a hard job. It's hard enough when you were elected. Somehow, nobody's always happy with taxes.
you very much. I thought you were going to sing an acapella song there, the three guys. Something. Thank you. All right, thanks for hanging in there, everybody. We are in the home stretch here. Next, we're going to get Solicitor General Jason Kane to come on up. Jason Kane, music, please.
I'll stay there. I like the ball when I talk. Jason Kane, I'm running for Solicitor General here in Wales County. And what Solicitor General is a fancy name and the prosecutor of Wales County State Court. To tell you who I am, I was born and raised here in Wales County. I like to tell people who my family is. My wife and I have been married for about 27 years. She's a teacher at AR Elementary School. We have three children who are actually grown now. Our son, Cameron, is teaching, and he's an assistant coach at Valdosta High School. We have a daughter, Courtney, who is a parapro at the AR Elementary School. And she has given me and my wife a beautiful little granddaughter. And in September, she'll be about 2 years old. Our youngest child finished over at Mr. Payton's school back in the spring and has gotten a job at Valdosta Orthopedics as a radiology coach. The Solicitor General's job, as I said, is the prosecutor for Lowndes State Court. And they handle different types of misdemeanor cases, anywhere from shoplifting to marijuana cases, vehicular homicide cases. And the family violence and vehicular homicide case is probably the most serious, in my opinion, the probably most serious charge that the state court prosecutor would have here in Lowndes County. I've been a lawyer since 1994. My experience includes working as a juvenile court judge, assistant district attorney, and for about the last 11 years, I've been an assistant public defender here in Valdosta, here in the Southern Circuit. And my duties have included representing defendants charged with felony offenses here in the Southern Circuit. In particular, Eccles, Lowndes, and Brooks County are the areas that I live defend people in. I've handled every kind of case that the state court system here in Lowndes County handles or prosecutes for them. As far as the solicitor's office, I've handled the drug cases, I've handled the vehicular homicides, I've actually tried a vehicular homicide case to a jury verdict, and I thought that the proper verdict was rendered. And that it was a successful representation on behalf of the defendant, the client. I've also tried three murder cases. I've tried drug possession cases. I've tried aggravated assault cases. I believe I have the experience necessary to run the office and to act as a prosecutor here for Lowndes County. The solicitor's office or the Solicitor General election is like several of these elections that will happen here in Lowndes County. It's going to be one of those that's listed down the ballot. And so I ask you that when you do go to vote, exercise your right and go all the way down the ballot and look at all the races that you're allowed to vote on. Don't just go to the top of it and hit the presidential race or your U.S. representative or your state senate race. Go down the ballot and look for some of your local elections. Us local candidates, no matter which way you vote, us local candidates would appreciate voting on our election, on our race. But the Solicitor General race, as I said, Solicitor General is a fancy name for being the state court prosecutor here in Lowndes County. My name is Jason Kane. I ask you if you would give me consideration when you vote for Solicitor General here in Lowndes County. Thank you.
All right, thank you. Next, we have Teresa Moffitt. Let's get Joyce Evans on here. Never mind. Sorry about that. Joyce Evans, you want to? She's running out of pose, but she wants to say a few words. Sounds like Joyce music.
Contract is written that we ask advanced disposal or any other companies to look into recycling and taking that extra expense and saving our planet. I mean, we're supposed to be good stewards. We were handed this planet, and I feel like we need to take care of it. Another thing that's really near and dear, anybody that knows I'm real big on animals. I would like to see our shelter eventually become a no-kill shelter. We have enough animal rescue groups in our area that we could reach out to and make this happen. We need to be, as a county, spreading the word about spray and neutering and creating some programs of our own to educate our citizens so we will quit having these unwanted puppies that lead to more animals dying in our shelters and being neglected. Our current commission did do the no tethering laws. I really, really appreciated that. I don't think any animal should be tied up outside. I feel like they should be a part of any family. I would appreciate your support. I would appreciate your vote. If anybody would be willing to put a sign in their yard, I have signs, let me know. I'll bring you one. I'll be out and about in the community until November, and I really appreciate everyone, and I need your prayers and your vote. Thank you.